Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Bhai Modi ji, respected Leader of the House Sri Arun Jaitley ji, respected Leader of the Opposition Sri Gulam Nabi Azad ji, Honorable Deputy Chairman Sri P.J. Kurian ji, Honorable Ministers, distinguished members of this August House. When I first entered this August House as a member in 1998, I never had even the faintest of the idea that one day I would have the honor of presiding over this House as chairperson. This is the beauty and majesty of our parliamentary democracy and its strength as well. It can lift a commoner like me to such an exalted position and offer opportunities to discharge onerous responsibilities that go with this position. I am from a small village, son of a farmer, even now fond of agriculture, because the basic culture of India is agriculture. I feel proud I am an agriculturalist. From there, I had a long journey. You are all aware of it. And finally, in spite of my humble background, and I don't have any, even I lost my father and mother also at a very young age. I lost my mother at the age of 1 year, 3 months or 4 months. I can't even recollect my mother's face. But keeping in view the responsibilities that has cast upon me in various levels, I try to do my best, and finally, you people, members of parliament of both the houses, have been kind enough to elect me as the Vice President of India. I feel really humbled by the honor given to me. I have also been given the responsibility of presiding over this house, Vice President, and assisting the President, performing the constitutional responsibilities, and also presiding over this August House, the Upper House. I am grateful to all the concerned for reposing faith and confidence in me and entrusting such responsibility to me. I don't no more talk about parties, which party has supported me, which party has not. That is not an issue. It's over now. Now I am an all-party man, above party politics. Aur wo jo Anand Sharma ji ne apeksha vyakt kiya nirapeksha ke sandarbh mein, main unka apeksha ko zarur pura karunga, nishchint rahiye. I'll be a person above politics, and then I will try to see that this house is functional. Every one of you get an opportunity, and small or big is not the issue, but only thing is everybody follows the rules and regulations or the procedures, then everybody will definitely get an opportunity. Before I elaborate on my thoughts as the chairman of this August House, I would like to briefly reflect on the origin and role of this Federal Chamber of Parliament of India. With its roots in the Montague Chelmsford Report of 1918, the Council of States first came into being in 1921. Further to the Government of India Act 1919, as the second chamber of the then legislature with a restricted franchise. Subsequently, there were extensive debates on the need for this house in the Constituent Assembly. It was considered that a single directly elected house should be inadequate to meet the challenges before free India. Accordingly, the Council of States was created as a federal chamber, that is, house elected by the elected members. An element of dignity and prestige was accorded to this chamber by making the Vice President of India the ex officio chairman of this house. The learned members of the Constituent Assembly envisaged this chamber as a house of reflective and evaluative reasoning. Late Sri N. Gopalaswamy Iyengar termed it as a house which can rein in passions of the movement. Late Sri Lokanath Misraji described it as a sobering house, a reviewing house, a house standing for equality, quality, and the members will exercise their right to be heard on the merit of what they say. The members will exercise their right to be heard on the merit of what they say, for their sobriety and knowledge of special problems, unquote. This House of Elders is meant to ensure federal equilibrium and equanimity in legislation. A provision has also been made to nominate a good number of knowledgeable persons from different walks of life to further enrich the debates. That's the purpose. This also is also expected to protect the interest of the states in the federal scheme of things. This goes to prove that this August House has a clear mandate to perform, provided the members do not desire, even if unintentionally, to reduce role to that of a superfluous and irrelevant one, as is already being referred to in some quarters in a muted manner. It is a choice in the hands of the honourable members. Honourable members, as the world's largest democracy, the fastest growing economy, our country needs efficient and effective legislation to administer its processes, mobilize resources, build partnerships, ensure socio-economic equality, etc. The entire world economy is slowing down. Even our neighbor, which is a powerful economy, is going a little negative. We are fortunate. We are the one country, India, that is Bharat, which is moving forward and which has got a bright future. Honourable members, time is not on our side. Even after 70 years of independence, we are grappling with basic issues of poverty, illiteracy, inequality, agrarian and rural development challenges, abuse of power sometimes by various levels, and then even regional inequalities, economic disparities, and even as some of countries similarly placed at the time of our attaining freedom are marching ahead with a lot more focus and a sense of urgency, marshalling their energies in a much better manner. So keeping these challenges in mind, we must all come together, work together, and then try to take the country forward. For the success of an individual, institution, or a nation, time management is very crucial. We don't have the luxury of time. We need to make up for the lost opportunities over the last 7 decades. If our country were to realize its potential, full potential, given its huge stock of human and natural resources and other advantages, we have a great human resource and a great intellect and a great culture and heritage bestowed upon us by our forefathers. This August House meets for much less than 100 days per year. Should the honorable members not make the best use of this available time in furtherance of the cause of our country and the people? The choice is to be made by the enlightened members. We take pride in our diversity and unity that flows from it. If that be the case, can't we be united in the pursuit of common national goals and in enabling young Indian realize its aspirations? Our democratic polity allows flourishing of different ideas and thoughts on a range of socio-economic issues. But adversarial politics should not be allowed to adversely impact the functioning of Parliament, which in turn impacts the progress of our nation. We are all Indians. We are all working for the betterment of India in our own sphere of activity, according to the principles in which we believe. We may belong to different parties, but our common aim is to strengthen India, to make India stable and strong and prosperous, to see that the fruits of development reach the man in the last line. What do you call it? Antyodaya, uplifting the poorest of the poor. So in a political democracy, a sacred instrument for pursuit of national interest, but a factious polity finding its echo in the legislature impedes the forward march of our country and the people. No chamber of our parliamentary democracy can be allowed to be an extension of such a fractious polity. We are only rivals. I firmly believe, I am speaking from my heart, my friends, honourable members, we are all political rivals. We are not enemies. As I said, each one, according to his belief, is working hard, pursuing his own political thought and process to strengthen the country, to help the people. So keeping that in mind, we must act together. We must come together. We must discuss. And yesterday, I can share with you, I had an occasion to go and meet the outgoing president, Sri Honorable Sri Pranab Mukherjee. Is one of the most senior politicians and statesmen of the country. And he told me what he had said earlier. I repeat what he said. He said, Parliament should discuss, debate, decide. Not the last D. it is very easy to say, but at the same time, it is not impossible to implement also. Keeping that in mind, I hope that everybody understands. Every election gives the winner a mandate, and the opposition the responsibility of ensuring accountability of the executive. I have been in opposition for a long time. The ruling party has the power. The opposition must at least have its say. But at the end of the day, the democracy says opposition must have its say and the government must have its way, because it is as per the mandate of the people. And all of us must respect the mandate of the people. His friends, democracy is not only about numbers, but also trying to understand and appreciate each other's point of view. It does not necessarily mean that we reduce the functioning of our legislature to a mere numbers game. The play of numbers should stop with the formation of governments, and thereafter it should be resorted only in the rarest of rare cases. As just now, when our leader of the opposition was mentioning earlier, even the other senior members were saying, when we function, when we discuss in depth. And also, we always offer an enlightened debate better than others. That has the general feeling. But the only issue is we must discuss. We must debate. And then we decide. Then we'll be able to deliver best. So this is my request to all of you. The play of numbers should stop with the formation of the government, and thereafter it should be resorted only in the rarest of rare cases. An emerging economy like ours should be guided more by a shared destiny in the functioning of our legislature. More and more discussion, referring it to committees, and then discussion in the committee goes beyond party lines. I myself was chairman of committees, particularly home committee. I was chairman for 5 years. Even on important issues, tricky issues, at the end of the day, we used to come to some common understanding. As there is no media and there is no other this thing, people used to speak out of their heart and then what they used to believe, and used to appreciate and understand each other's point of view. That's why the historic land boundary agreement by both the House of Parliament, and even the historic GST bill, and even the historic legislation that have been passed over the years, not only during this regime, even earlier regimes also, were the products of correct wisdom of both the House of Parliament. That was after a meaningful debate. Honourable members, all that people of our country desires is that the Parliament should be the voice of sanity, echoing their concerns and finding solutions to their problems as the best way forward. Over the years, both the House of Parliament have done a reasonably good job. But somehow, there is a growing concern, resentment among the people about our functioning. As a parliamentary affairs minister, I used to go and meet the media at the end of the session and then outline how many legislations have been approved, how many hours we sat, how we made up the last of time, etc. But at the same time, as some of the members were suggesting today from the back benches or from the so-called small parties, the time that is available is in the middle also, and in the middle also, in front, left, right, and straight. Everybody is bright. I'm aware of it. But point is, only a question of management of time. The time management, if you are able to utilize the full time, you have enough time. If you spend time in procedural angles and other things, then the time that will be lost, that will be lost to the smaller parties and ordinary members. So keeping that in mind, I will try to do my best to see that everyone gets their right and their due also while debates take place. All that is needed is an attitude of give and take. This is possible through strategizing for effective functioning of the House rather than for its disruption. This needs an enlightened approach on the part of all concerned. I always say, government, let the government propose. Let the opposition oppose, let the House dispose, either way, this way or that way. That is the way forward. Unfortunately, obstruction and disruption of the proceedings is increasingly being chosen as the first parliamentary option. I don't want to dwell on that, but countrymen are getting disillusioned sometimes. When they see, because the live coverage is there, when they see what is happening, they get disillusioned. We must understand their feelings. And now, we are in an aspirational India. India that is moving forward. The younger generation are taking more and more interest in the public affairs of the country. Their, that in mind, their aspirations, we must live up to their expectations. The school children, they look to legislature, they look to parliament, and the people in general of the other countries, they also look to Indian democracy, because we are the finest parliamentary democracy in the world. So friends, what I say is that let us utilize the time that is available in an effective manner. I'll be more than happy if you all come together, and the government also is willing to extend the time of the sittings of the House. I'll be more than happy to welcome it. I can only impress upon the government, provided the time is that is already available, if it is spent meaningfully, constructively, then we can plead our case, make a request and suggest to the government to extend the session time. When you are not able to utilize the time that is already made available to you, then going and asking, that will not have any rational and it will not be appreciated. So I hope in the coming days we will be able to put our best efforts together, and the best way of enforcing accountability of the executive by the opposition is to engage the government and corner them in an informed debate. I have an experience in legislature. Keshara was mentioning about it, and also Subram Reddy and others know. I used to be a very bitter critic, but at the same time never used to cross the line. That we enjoyed it also as an opposition. The best part of my legislative life is the time when I was in opposition rather than in position. The Vijay is nodding his head. this side. Because we had a constructive debate, and we used to score points, and we used to feel happy. At this juncture, I also have an advice to the media, as the chairman of the House, who is the custodian of this House. The media also should report the constructive debates that take place in the House. Members come prepared. I have seen some of the members, as and when debate is allowed, they make very valuable contribution. They make a lot of good references. But unfortunately, media, that's the feeling among all the members, including myself, the media is only giving weightage to sensationalism, to negativism, to controversies, and to dramatics, rather than realistic attitude. So I have a suggestion to the media. Media is free. We are in independent India. I can't direct them. But the only thing is I can convey to them from this chair in the beginning of this my tenure, please focus more on constructive debate. I want to share with each one of you, when I came here to this House, I was asked to speak on agriculture, which was my favorite subject. I prepared myself, went to the library, gone through Swaminathan Commission recommendation, gone through so many reports and speeches of Acharya Ranga, the great agriculture former raider and all. And after a lot of effort, I prepared and came here to the House, and I was allowed, thanks to the chairman at the time, I was given 52 minutes time. Because my at that time, that party which I belonged, they also had substantial time. They are colleagues allocated. Everybody came to me. Even Swaminathanji himself and Sharad Pawarji, Ramgopal Yadavji, Raja and all, they complimented for my speech. Next day, to my disappointment, there is no mention except one paper said Mr. Venkaiah Naidu spoke elaborately on agriculture problems. So there is a heart burning among the members. You report what is happening here. I am not saying, I have no right to advise you that way. But at the same time, report what also is positively happening in the House, what is being constructively debated. That is the duty, sacred duty of the media also. So I thought I should give this advice from the chair, for the friends from the media also. Because mere sensationalism alone is not going to happen. And one headline is not going to be a deadline. The main line is the thinking of the parliamentarians and the corrective decision of the parliamentarians. That is the main line that has to be taken care. Friends, we as a upper house, we must show the way forward to other legislatures across the country. As a member of this August House for more than 19 years, and most of it is an opposition member, I am aware of the sensitivity of both the sides of the House, the rules of business, the rights and privileges of the honourable members, the feelings and even frustrations on some occasions. I am also conscious that eminent persons like Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, Dr. Jakir Hussain, Justice Hidayatullah, Sri R. Venkatramanji, Dr. Shankar Dayal Sharma, Sri K. R. Narayanan, Sri Bairan Singh Shekhawatji, and others had presided over the proceedings of this August House with the distinction. We have also been fortunate to observe Sri Hamid Ansari, the outgoing Vice President, who had a diplomatic career and who conducted this House. That's all there in front of us. My immediate predecessor, Sri Hamid Ansari, did so for 10 years. It shall be my endeavor to uphold the traditions and standards set by these worthy people. All that, I am also happy to have an able and experienced colleague and deputy, Sri P.J. Kurian, because I have seen him taking most of the suffering from the chair, at the same time, normally not losing cool and maintaining balance and trying to sometimes it, because at the gravest provocation, after all, everybody is a human being, is not God, is also a human being. All that I would like to appeal to the honourable members on this occasion is that, keep in mind, the poorest of the poor who is wanting to be recognised, the poorest of the poor of the country, they need to be recognised, their voice to be heard, their aspirations has to be understood, and they have to be met. That should be uppermost in our mind, and they should not be deprived of their rightful opportunity, which is guaranteed under the Constitution, which is part of our parliamentary democracy. Friends, let us be guided by the shining principles of our Constitution, the ideals of freedom struggle, the noble thoughts of great souls like Mahatma Gandhi, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, and all other leaders who gave their sweat and blood for bringing our country this far. Always be reminded of the great speeches made by great leaders. As a legislator, I used to go to library and read what Indrajit Guptaji has said, what Bhupesh Guptaji has said, what Nadpaji has said, what Vajpayee has said, what Pilu Modi has said, what Mini Mosani has said, what Acharya Ranga has said in the assembly, what Tenet Viswanathamji has said, what Gautam Lassana has said, what are used to be the great speeches of Anna of Tamil Nadu. These things I keenly observed, that really brought me to this place. I am sharing with you, I am opening my mind and sharing with you. Otherwise, I have no support of dynasty. I come from a very humble family, and from there to reach here was, one is hard work, second is study. So I request upon all the members, there are many seniors here, of course, will be missing Sitaram Yechuriji, one of the senior most members of this House and very experienced and knowledgeable person of different ideologies. Nothing wrong. That's the beauty of democracy. So friends, we must all work hard to get the due place in the Committee of Nations and ensure smile on the face of every citizen. Let us be guided by the right of the people for a better future. There is a certain new sense of purpose and urgency being demonstrated by the union and state governments in a spirit of competitive and cooperative federalism. I am happy the Honorable Prime Minister has given a call that center and states must work as Team India. Team India. That is the need of the hour. Not only center and state, but also the local bodies. Keeping in view the spirit of the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment, where the powers to be given to the lower level of the democratic system, 3 F's, funds, functions and functionaries, should be transferred to the local bodies also, be it panchayats or municipalities. That should be our guiding principles. So keeping that in mind, we must start from ourselves. We must all work in the spirit of a competitive and cooperative federalism to quicken the pace of development, to offer more opportunities to people for bettering their lives. Let us play the role of a catalyst in fulfilling this national quest. I would like to assure you that it shall be my endeavor to uphold the dignity of the office of Vice President of India, Chairman of the Rajya Sabha, and live up to the trust you have reposed in me. I am at your service and always open to your suggestions for improving the functioning of this August House as per your corrective wisdom. In the end, I would like to remind the honourable members of the resolution adopted by this August House at the special session of the occasion of the Golden Jubilee of our independence in 1997, after 50 years of independence, both the houses, they sat together, discussed elaborately, and approved a pledge. The members resolved to preserve and enhance the prestige of the Parliament by conscious and dignified conformity to the entire regime of rules of procedure and conduct of the business of the houses and direction of the presiding officers. Some of the members have suggested that the tradition of not passing the bill in DIN should be continued. I hope that there won't be any scope for such a situation. No DIN and then no passage of bill in a DIN. Both can go together. If we have a quiet atmosphere and if we have a meaningful discussion, then we can pass the legislations after thorough discussion. That's how I think about it. Friends, I again conclude by saying, recalling what Sri Pranab Mukherjee ji, the outgoing president, has said, let us debate, discuss and decide. Let us forget, disrupt. I would like to thank you all from the bottom of my heart for giving me this opportunity. Namaskar.